Lectures number 7, Variation Spawn. In these chapters, we're going to learn about the key characteristics of bond. For bond variations, we can apply the present value formulas and also the present value of annuity formulas. In the bond variation formulas, we can flip the equations to find the bond yields or U to maturity bond. In the last section of the lectures, we're going to learn about relevant risk in bond investment. Bond is a long-term debt instrument. It is a fixed income securities, which means these securities will offer fixed payment every period. They will provide both interest payments and at maturities, these debt instruments will provide the principal repayment to the bond investors. Key characteristics of a bond. The bond that we will use in our lectures will have a par value of $1,000, or in Thailand, it will have a par value equal to 1,000 baht. Every period, bonds will offer a fixed payment, which is equal to the stated interest rate multiplied by the face value of the bond. We call this one the coupon payment. At maturities, the bond holders will be repaid with the principal amount or the face value of the bond. For you to maturity, this is the rate of returns earned on the bond if investors hold the bonds until it matures. It is also called the promised yield because the actual rate of returns on bond investment might be different from the yield to maturities calculated from the bond variations model. Let's look at a specific types of bond, callable bond. The callable bond allow the bond issuers to refund the bond before the bonds matures. For example, if a company issue callable bond, the company, which is an issuer in this example, can call the bonds back before the bonds mature. Bond issuers who are the borrower must offer attractive rate of returns to the bond investor who are the lenders. Most callable bonds will have a deferred call, which means there may be some protection period that the bonds cannot be called. For example, this bond is called protected during the first 3 years. So in these first 3 years, the bond issuers cannot call the bond back. Callable bonds are like straight bond or regular bond plus call options on the bond. So the rate of returns offered on callable bonds must include a call premium, which allow the bond issuers to exercise the call options or to call the bonds back before the bonds mature. Convertible bonds. These bonds allow the holders of the bond to convert bond into stock, for example, and the bond holder will have the options to do that. Warrant. It is a long-term option to buy a certain number of common stock at a specific price. Puttable bond is a normal bond plus a put option. So this allows the bond holders to sell the bonds back to the companies before it matures or to put the bond back to the issuers. Income bond. This type of bond will pay only the interest rate. Index bond. The coupon's interest payment of this bond will be indexed to the rate of inflation. So bondholders will be able to earn more returns if there is inflation in the economy. Bond investors will get paid more to adjust for the rate of inflation and compensate for the purchasing power as a result of inflation. For the variations of bonds, under a variation framework of any financial asset, we will find the present value of future cash flow. This timeline diagram shows you the time period and the associated cash flow with each period. CF1 is the cash flow at year 1, CF2 cash flow at year 2. The discount rate used here is R, which represents the rate of returns on this investment. And this rate of returns must be compensated for the risk that investors have to take. Investors can find the value of any asset by looking into the future cash flow, year 1, year 2, until the security or the bond matures at year end and discount it into present value. Sum them up, then you will find the present value of this financial asset. The trick is, how would you set up the discount rate? The discount rate is the rate of return that compensates for the risk that investor have to take. For example, if you invest in bond, the rate of returns of bond must equal to the basic real rate of returns plus inflation premium plus maturity risk premium plus default risk premium plus liquidity premiums. These are the premiums. This part represents the rate of returns that compensate for the risk investor have to take. The type of risk involved is inflation risk, maturity risk, default risk, and liquidity risk. Now let's look at an example. Let's say we have a 10-year bond. This bond offers 10% annual coupons. An investor requires a rate of returns equal to 10%. Please notice that 10% interest rate is equal to the rate of return that investor require from this investment. To find the value of bonds today, we have to look into the future cash flows. So this bond has a face value equal to $1,000. The bond offer a coupon interest payments equal to 10% per year. So every year an investor will receive $100 until the bonds mature at year 10. The maturities are n equal to 10 years. So it is similar to finding a present value of annuities, which represent interest payments of $100 every year over 10 years, plus the present value of face value of the bonds at the end of year 10. So at the end of year 10, when the bond matures, we receive $1,000, which equal to the face value of the bond. Sum them up, you get the present value of this bond equal to $1,000. In this valuation framework, there are two components. The first component represents the present value of annuities, plus the second component, which is the present value of the face value of the bond. The first example here is the easiest one. We know that the bond has a face value equal to $1,000, and the bonds will mature in 10 years. So n is equal to 10, and it says 10 here in the formulas. The bonds offer a coupon interest payments of 10% a year. So we use 10% multiplied by $1,000. Every year, a bonds investor receive $100 payment for 10 years. Discount this future cash flow into present time, sum them up, you get the current value or present value of this bond equal to $1,000. Now let's observe a discount rate of 10%. This 10% is a discount rate that represents the rate of return for the bond investor, RD. Again, notice that this 10% annual interest rate is used to calculate the interest payment every period. This 10% is the required rate of returns from bond investment. Is used as a discount rate to find the present value of the bond. For the first example, the bond offer 10% annual coupon rate, and the investor required the rate of returns equal to 10%. These two numbers are the same. As a result, the value of the bond is equal to the par value of $1,000. So the par value of the bond is $1,000 in this example. You can also use a calculator by plugging in the payments equal to $100 and the future value equal to the par value or the face value of the bond, $1,000. $1,000, which is the par value of this bond. Solve for PV. That's the present value of bond, or the price of this bond. Now let's do some adjustment. Let's say we still stay with 10 years bond. The investor also required the rate of return, which is equal to 10%. But in this example, the bond offer the annual coupon interest payments of 13%. So every period, the annual interest payment from the bond will be $130. That's our PMT. The par value or the face value of the bond is still $1,000. The bond has the maturities of 10 years. Solving for the present value of this bond, we get the value of the bonds equal to $1,184, which is a premium bond. This bond must be sold at premiums because the coupon rate of 13% greater than the required rate of returns, or the yield on this bond of 10%, right here. Example number 3, we're still dealing with a similar bond. This bond has a 10 years time to maturity, so N is equal to 10 years. The required rate of returns for the bond investor is still 10% because this bond has the same risk as our previous bond. So I or R equal to 10%. The face value of the bond or the par value of the bond is still equal to $1,000 as before. This term, the bonds offer a 7% annual coupon interest payment. So every year, the investor will receive a payment equal to $70. PMT is equal to $70. You solve the equations, we get the present value of this bond equal to $815. The value is below $1,000. The present value of this bond is less than the face value of $1,000. So the bond is sold at discount. And this is because the coupon interest rate of 7% is less than the required rate of returns or the yield of this bond, which is equal to 10%. Let's recap now. To find the value of the bond, we will find the present value of future cash flow. If we draw a timeline into the futures until the maturities of the bond at N years, we will first find out the cash flow associated, which is time period. Then using a discount rate, which is the required rate of returns for the bond investment, we discount the future cash flow into present time. The present value can be a proxy for the price of bond at present time. Our first example starts with 10 years bond. This bond has a par value equal to $1,000, or the face value of the bond is equal to $1,000. The bond offers the annual coupon interest payment equal to 10%. An investor requires the rate of returns equal to 10%. The fair price of this bond at present time is just equal to $1,000, which is the par value of this bond. With bond of similar risk, 10 years bond, required rate of returns equal to 10%. This bond offers the annual coupon payments of 13%. So the coupon rate is greater than the required rate of returns on this bond. We will get the value of the bond greater than $1,000. We call this bond a premium bond. For the bonds of similar risk and same time to maturity, this bond offers the annual coupon interest payments of 7%. So the coupon rate of this bond is less than 10% required rate of returns. This bond must be sold at discount. The calculation of this bond will be less than $1,000 or less than par. So we have an example of three types of bond. When investor have a required rate of returns equal to 10%, if the bond also offer 10% coupon rate, we have a par bond. If the bonds offer 13% rate of returns, we have a premium bond. When the bond offer the coupon interest payment only 7%, the bond must be sold at discount. However, whether it's a premium bond, a discount bond, or a par bond, at maturities, which is 10 years from now, the value of the bond will be equal to $1,000 when the bonds mature. When the bond mature at year 10, investor will receive back $1,000, which is the face value of this bond. At maturity, the value of the bond must be equal to its par value or face value. In our example, we hold the required rate of return constant at 10%. For the premium bond, at the end, investor will also get $1,000. For the discount bond, at maturity, investor will also receive $1,000, as well as the par bond, $1,000 at maturity. Bond valuation model. If we know the value of the bond today, we can find the rate of returns of this bond investment if we hold the bonds until it matures. This concept is called yield to maturity, or the rate of returns on bond investment if you hold the bond until the bonds matures. An example, this bond has a par value equal to $1,000. So this is the value of your investment when the bond matures. The time to maturity of this bond is 10 years. The equations N will be equal to 10. When the bond mature, an investor will receive $1,000, which is the face value of the bond or the par value of this bond. This bond offers the annual coupon interest payment equal to 9%. 9% of $1,000 is $90 every year from year 1 until year 10. When the bond matures, we still have an information on the current price of this bond. At present time, the bond is selling at $887. We put $887 on the left side of the equation. In this equation, we solve for RD, which is the returns investor would expect if they hold the bonds until it matures. Solving this equation, you can see that the bond offer 9% coupon interest payment. This bond is now sold at discount $887. If you use a financial calculator, the size between PV and FV must be the opposite. So if you pay $887 to buy this bond, it's negative numbers here. And when the bonds mature in 10 years, you will receive $1,000 face value. It's positive numbers here. Solving for I, which is yield to maturity or the rate of returns if you hold the bonds until it mature. The yield to maturity is equal to 10.91%. Comparing with the coupons payments of 9%. The promised yield on this investment of 10.91% is greater than the coupon interest payment of 9%. Because this bond is selling at a discount, you buy this bond at cheaper price and hold the bond until it mature. Your returns gonna be more than 9% per year. If you buy the bond at discount, your rate of returns or promised yield or yield to maturity will be greater than the coupon interest payment. On the other hand, if bond is sold at premium, so the current price of this bond will be more than $1,000. An example, the price of this bond is $1,134. The bonds offer 9% coupon interest payment, so you get $90 because it's 9% multiplied by $1,000 face value. The bonds will mature in 10 years. Solving for R, you get the rate of return each year equal to 7.08%. So your promised yield or your yield to maturity will be less than 9% coupon interest payment because this bond is sold at premiums. You buy this bond at an expensive price, your rate of returns will be lower than the coupon interest payment. Another type of bond yield is called current yield. Current yield is very easy to calculate. You use the annual coupons payments as the numerators divided by current bond price in the market. For example, if the price of the bonds is equal to $887, so the bond price P887 is your denominator. The coupon interest payment is calculated by using 9% coupon rate multiplied by the face value of $1,000. So that's $90. So as if you buy the bond today, hold it for 1 year, and receive the coupons payment, your current yield will be equal to 10.15%. This is an easy way to calculate the current bond yield, so it's often reported in the newspaper. When you invest in bond, you will receive total returns. So your total return is the promised yield, or YTM in our example. It will be equal to the current yield plus the capital gain yield. Capital gain yield represents a percentage change in the price of this bond, which at present time we do not know because we do not know the level of interest rate in the future. For the lectures, we hold the levels of yield constant until the bonds mature. That's why we can calculate yield to maturity or promised yield based on a fixed level of required rate. Continue with an example. We have calculated the yield to maturity on bond equal to 10.91%. If we hold the bonds for 1 year, we will receive a yield of 10.15% based on the coupon interest payment. So the yield on this capital gain or changes in the price of this bond is only 0.76%. This is an example of how you could apply the relationship to calculate expected capital gain yield or percentage change in the price of the bond, holding the economic condition constant. This part will discuss a particular interest rate risk with bond investment. We have two types of bond. Short-term bond which has the life of 1 year, long-term bond with the life of 10 years. Both bond has the par value or face value equal to $1,000. Now we're going to change the level of interest rate in the market, which will change the required rate of returns or RD for the investors. Given RD equal to 10%, both bond has the 10% coupon interest rate. So those bonds will be sold at par or $1,000. With interest rate in the market drops, the required rate of return drop from 10% to 5%. At 5% required rate of returns, the price of bond will go up from $1,000 to $1,048 for short-term bond. But for 10 years bond or longer term bond, the price will move up by a greater percentage. So percentage change in the price of longer term bond will be more than percentage change in the price of shorter term bond. This is the price risk or interest rate risk when you invest in bond. The price of longer term bond will change more, or the price of longer term bond are more sensitive to change it in the interest rate. Now let's look at the opposite scenario. When the level of interest rate in the economy go up, your required rate of returns go up from 10% to 15%. With higher discount rate, the price of bond will drop below par. So the price of shorter term bond will drop by 4.4%. But the price of longer term bond will drop more. Price drop by 25% from $1,000 drop to $748. You have capital losses. Why this is the case? Because for a shorter term bond or 1 year bond in this example, 1 year from now, this bond will mature and you will receive the face value equal to $1,000. When the bonds mature. So regardless of the level of interest rate in the market today, next year you as the bondholder will receive $1,000 because the bond will mature in 1 year. On the other hand, for 10 years bond, you have to wait until year 10 to receive $1,000. So there are more risks involved with longer term investment. Investor must be compensated with maturity risk premiums for longer term bond. For a positive situation, what benefit do investors get when they invest long term? Look at this example. Both bonds offer the annual coupon interest payment equal to 10%. So if the level or the required rate of returns is equal to 10%, both bonds will be sold at par. But because 10 years bond, an investor can lock in 10% coupon interest payment for over 10 years. When the level of interest rate in the market drop, required rate of return drop, let's say from 10 to 5%. For 1 year bond, the bonds will mature next year. An investor will have to find another place to invest their money, and they can do shopping and get the returns on the bond only 5%. On the other hand, 10 years bond, an investor can lock in an interest rate of 10% over 10 years. That's why the price of this bond go up a lot. This bond become a premium bond. Because in the market next year, you cannot find any bond that offer the 10% coupon interest payment in the market anymore. So that's why the price of this bond must be adjusted upward. Is this a good bond? Is this a premium investment? On the other hand, if the level interest rate go up, your required rate of returns move up from 10 to 15%. At 15%, both bonds offer the coupons payment of 10%. So both bonds must be sold at discount. But you can see that for shorter term bond, the price drop is only 4%. Because by next year, this bond will mature and investor will receive $1,000 face value from 1 year bond. An investor can find a new investment alternatives that will offer the rate of returns of 15%, just wait for 1 year. On the other hand, for 10 years bond, an investor must wait for 10 years for the bonds to mature and get $1,000 back. If investor want to sell this 10 years bond today and find another investment alternative that offer 15% rate of returns, this bond will be sold at deep discount. So the price will drop by 25%. This bond is no longer an attractive investment. 10 years bond offer 10% coupon interest rate. If an investor go elsewhere, they will get 15%. So if they have to invest in this bond, the longer term bond must be sold at discount. Along with the interest rate risk is the reinvestment risk. This reinvestment risk represent a situation that an investor will have to find a place to reinvest their money. If the level of interest rate in the market is at lower rate, so the reinvestment rate might be lower than the initial investment. In our example, if you invest in shorter term bond, the bonds will mature quickly and you will have to find a new place to invest your money. And then if the level of interest rate in the market drops, the new rate of returns from your new investment will be lower than the previous one. This is called reinvestment risk. Nothing is riskless. Longer term investment, the price of this longer term bond will fluctuate more when interest rate change. So it has higher price risk. For shorter term bond, you have to find a new place to reinvest your money. So it has higher reinvestment risk. So that's a trade-off between price risk and reinvestment risk. Shorter term investment versus long term investment. In a practical world, most bonds are semi-annual coupon bonds, which means the bonds will offer coupon interest payment twice a year or every 6 months. We need to make some adjustment. We have to adjust the number of years by multiplying by 2. Because each year there are 2 payments, one every 6 months. The interest rate must be adjusted to be per 6 month basis, so we will divide the required rate of returns by 2. The coupon interest payment, which represents your 6 month income, the annual coupon must also be divided by 2. Two items that do not need to be adjusted are the future value or the face value of the bonds. The par value of the bond remains the same. The current price or the present value of the bond also needs no adjustment. Look at an example. For 10 years bond, N will be equal to 20 periods because each year the bonds will offer the payment twice every 6 months. The required rate of returns for bond investment is 13% per year. It must be adjusted to be 6.5% per 6 months. This bond offered a 10% coupon payment, but it paid every 6 months or semi-annual payment. The par value of the bond is $1,000. 10% per year is $100, but it offered the payments twice a year, so you divide $100 payment into every 6 months is equal to $50 per 6 months. That's your PMT. Solving this equation to find the current price of this bond. The bond is sold at discount for $834. Let's remark again why this bond is sold at discount. Because this bond offers the coupon payments equal to 10% a year. But investor require the rate of returns equal to 13%. Investor want 13%. The bonds offer 10%. So if investor need to buy this bond, they will buy at discount. The same concept still hold. The only adjustment are on the calculations of the value of bond. We can also apply the concept of effective interest rate or effective rate of returns for an investment in bond. This is a 10% semi-annual coupon bond. So 10% must be adjusted to be 5% per 6 months and then to the power of 2 because it's twice a year. The effective rate of returns on this bond will be more than 10% because the interest rate is compounded twice a year. Offer the effective rate of returns equal to 10.25%. This example is to reconcile between semi-annual coupon bond and annual coupon bond. If the price of semi-annual coupon bond equal to $1,000, what should be the present value or proper price for the annual coupon bond? In this example, what required is to put in the required rate of returns equal to 10.25% per year. So this is R or I in our calculation, and so for the present value of annual coupon bond. To make the annual coupon bonds as attractive as the semi-annual coupon bond, the price of this annual coupon bond must be sold at discount on $984. Then we will offer the effective rate of returns equal to 10.25%, which is the actual rate of returns on the semi-annual coupon bond. This section provides an example on how to calculate the rate of returns of callable bonds. In these examples, we have a 10 years callable bond. This bond pays coupon twice a year and the coupon rate is 10%. The bond is a premium bond. It is expected that the bonds will be called in year 8 for the call price of $1,050. Based on this information, we can calculate the rate of returns on this callable bond. It is called the yield to call. First of all, if this is a straight bond or non-callable bond, we could calculate the rate of returns if you hold the bond until it matures. The yield to maturity is 8%. But because the bond is expected to be called 8 years from now, so we put N equal to 8, and the future value is equal to the call price of $1,050. This is a 10% semi-annual coupon bond, so the coupon's payment every 6 months is $50. We have the current bond price, which is $1,135. Solving for R, 3.568%. This is the rate per 6 months. Then we have to multiply by 2 to get an annual rate. The yield to call for this callable bond is 7.137%. A discussion in this slide explains the corresponding concepts of yield to maturities and yield to call. If an investor holds this callable bond, it is more likely that an investor will be earning the yield to call rather than the yield to maturities, because these callable bonds are likely to be called by the bond issuer. Let's look at some numbers. This semi-annual coupon bond quoted a coupon rate of 10%. If the bond issuers call the bonds back and resell the new bond, the issuers might be able to offer the coupon rate, which is going to be lower than 10%. Let's say the required rate of returns at that time will be equal to the yield to call or the rate of returns of this bond, 7.13%. As the result, the corporations or the bond issuer will be able to save some coupon interest payment. So rather than offering a coupon rate of 10% and pay interest of $100 per year per one bond, the issuers might be able to quote a coupon rate equal to 7.137% and makes a coupon payment equal to $71 per year, a saving of almost $30 a year per one bond. So for callable bond, it is likely that the bondholders should expect that the bonds are going to be called by the bond issuers. They will earn the yield to call rather than the yield to maturities. This example just shows you that the bond is a premium bond and the coupon rate of 10% is greater than the rate of returns if the bonds are to be called at 7.137%. So the bonds is likely to be called. In the last section, we're going to discuss a default risk. If the bonds defaults, investors are going to receive less than what they expected. The default risk is mainly a function of the issuer financial strength, as well as the terms of the bond contracts. Now we have two rating agencies, Standard & Poor's and Moody's. Both have different credit ratings. Those are their trademark. For example, S&P use AAA, BBB, and CCC credit ratings. For Moody's, they use AAA, BAA, CAA to represent the corresponding credit ratings of the bond issuers. Bond rating reflect the probabilities that the bond issuers may go into default or get into a bankruptcy process. So AAA is the best credit ratings. The chance of getting into default is very small. For example, the probabilities that the bond issuers are going to default during the first 3 years might be 0%. For Thai government bonds, we receive a credit rating about BBB+. For the credit rating lower than BBB, those bonds are called speculative bonds or junk bonds. They must offer higher rate of returns to the investor for those bonds to be attractive. Let's look at an example of Thai corporate bond. In October 2020, the example shown here are perpetual bonds. They are bonds that have maturities equal to infinity. Their characteristics are much like equity. The first example is a perpetual bond from Sansiri Public Company Limited. These bonds are subordinated. The bonds has no collateralized asset. It offers the coupon interest payment of 8.5% per year. Examples number two show กสิกรแบงก์ or K-Bank Perpetual Bond. The coupon interest on their bonds will be 5.275% a year. The bank receives a credit rating equal to BBB+. The bonds are thus considered investment-grade bonds. From an example of K-Bank corporate bond, the bond received BBB+ credit ratings. They are investment-grade bonds. Factors that can have an impact on default risk and bond credit ratings. The first group of factors represent financial strength of the bond issuers, such as the debt ratios and the abilities for the firms to pay interest. The second group of factors depending on the terms of the bond contracts. For example, if the bonds are secure bonds, those bonds have the firm assets as collaterals to back up the borrowing, so the credit ratings of those secure bonds will be better than the unsecured borrowing. For example of Sansiri bond, there are subordinated bonds. These bonds have no asset back up the borrowing. Bond investors expect to receive coupons payment from the issuers based on the cash flow of their businesses. Other factors to be considered is whether the bonds are short terms or long terms. In our example, we see that the bonds are perpetual bonds, so the debt maturity is infinity. They act more or less like equity. There are also some other qualitative factors, such as the earning stability of the firms. For the last thing to be considered, if the firms getting into a bankruptcy process and the firm move into the liquidation process, the orders to be paid are first, secure creditor. For example, financial institutions such as commercial bank lend money to the firms, and the firm must use its asset as collateral to back up the borrowing. So these financial institutions will get paid first. The second persons in line would be those administrators. The firm must pay administrative costs that involve in the liquidation process. Then number three will be the employees. Number four will be the government. For subordinated unsecured debt, it is number six. These bondholders are just in front of the preferred stockholders and the owners. So be reminded that if you invest in subordinated bonds, you are unsecured creditors. You are number six in line. Thank you for your participation. Don't forget to do the exercise at the end of the chapters as usual. Good luck.